Everybody, if we can sit down, we're going to get going here. On behalf of the Cape Cod Hoarding Task Force, I'd like to welcome you all here. Thank you all for coming. Just a little housekeeping items here. If you are a registered sanitarian, we do have CEUs for this, so make sure that you have signed in out front. And also, you'll have an evaluation form. Make sure you send in the evaluation form, and then those CEUs will be mailed to you afterwards. Make sure all of you have your cell phones off or on vibrate. We don't want any interruptions. Restrooms are right back here, straight through the door. Go past the bar and into the, I know, I'm sorry, but at least till later anyway. Just to let you know, we are videotaping this event, the presentation. So if you have any questions, any discussions, you want to make sure that you don't use any names, we want to keep everybody's privacy. And just to let you know that we're videotaping. Anybody who does not know me, my name is Erica Woods. I am the Assistant Health Agent for the Town of Orleans, and I am also a steering committee member for the Cape Cod Hoarding Task Force. Here with us also today is Lee Manillo. She is a senior environmental specialist from Barnstable County. We have Deb Scavato, also a steering committee member from Smooth Moving for Seniors. We have Paul Wild, Cape and Islands Elder Services. And then we have Denise Egan-Stack from the Cape Cod Cognitive Behavioral Institute. Our group began in 2010, and it started off as the Mid-Cape Hoarding Task Force. And then interest grew, and other towns wanted to be involved. So we expanded to the full Cape Cod. So what we're trying to do is just bring different people together, providers. We have health agents, fire departments, police departments, trying to figure out this issue. We have a long way to go, but we've made a lot of great strides. Basically, right now, our goal is to raise awareness. We're trying to educate the community and the professionals. We try to have a couple events each year. This one for professionals, we've had other ones for community members. Buried and Treasures workshop we had, and we also did a viewing of my mother's garden a couple of years ago. So our name is getting out there, we're getting some information out there. We're trying to offer accessible tools, referrals, and resources for the community. And basically, we want to try to develop a coordinated response. It's such a tough issue. It involves so many people. We want to bring everybody together and try to find a good way to respond to this issue. For anybody who has not been to our meetings, we meet every other month, second Thursday of the month. Of course, as I say this, the next time we meet will not be on a second Thursday of the month. We're going to have a meeting in November. We don't have the date yet. What we're going to do is we're going to put all of you on our emailing list. We'll send that date out to you. It's open. You're more than welcome to come by. We usually have it at the Dennis Police Department. This one likely will be at the county complex. But again, we'll put your email on our emailing list. If you don't want to be on there, just send us an email and say, please take me off. We also have membership forms out there if anybody wants to join us. We have service provider forms out there too. What we're trying to do is put together a list of service providers so that, you know, if somebody wants a cleanup group or if they want a mental health specialist, they want somebody to work with them, we can actually hand them that list. We're trying to get together, we're trying to kind of vet these people so that we're not going to be able to recommend anybody, but at least it's some people that we've met and we know. So I think we've covered the CEUs, membership forms. From here, we have Jeff Turk. He is from the law firm of Turk and Keano. He is widely recognized as a leading expert in landlord-tenant law. He has written extensively and lectured on both national and local levels on topics as residential and commercial landlord-tenant law, reasonable accommodation, residential evictions and property management, and other topics. So with that, I welcome Jeff Turk. Thank you.
If she pronounces my partner's name right, Keano, it's a good start. So it's all downhill from here. So good morning.
Good morning.
Okay. Good morning.
Good morning.
I know it's early. There's caffeinated coffee in there. I cheated this morning and had a little extra caffeine to try to get us going. Wanted to start off by telling you a little bit about who I am, so you know where I'm coming from, because I'm probably in a little different position than most of you. I represent all landlords and a lot of housing authorities. I'm on the landlord side of things. I'm in the trenches. I'm in housing court and district court every day dealing with a lot of these issues. I like to say that I deal with more people with psychiatric issues than most psychiatrists do, and that's mainly the lawyers I'm dealing with, but also the residents. I bring the view of somebody that's actually dealing with these issues every day, and they're tough issues, right? This is not a black letter law lecture. I'm not going to tell you that in this case it was decided this, right? Because every one of these cases that we're dealing with really is very factually based, and there's no right answers here, right? So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what is hoarding, of the legal issues that we confront, and then hopefully talk about some practical solutions to those problems. Although I like to think I do, I don't have all the answers. And so I'm hoping that we're going to have an interactive dialogue here and be able to talk about things, because just because I've done it one way, you may have a great way that you've confronted these issues, and I think by sharing it, that's what this group is all about, sharing ideas and coming up with some positive ways to try to deal with, again, what is a very, very difficult issue. We only have 6 hours today to handle it. No, I'm kidding. We have about 3 hours. One of the challenges I have here is it's a very diverse group, right? Some of you are health inspectors, raise your hand. Sanitarians, attorneys, okay, fire, life safety people, anybody I missed? Other groups?
Social workers.
Okay.
Home care,
okay.
Building officials.
Okay. Building, okay. So a lot of people with wearing very different hats, but all dealing with the same issue. So it makes it a little challenging for me to make sure I'm hitting all the points. So I'm going to come with my viewpoint on things. Why teach this seminar? Why am I here? Hoarding is a growing issue. It's an ongoing issue. We see a hoarding case at least once a week in my office, at least. The pictures that we're going to look at in the brochure, those are real pictures, right? They didn't go on the internet to find them, and believe me, I could have filled up a stack like this of pictures, ranging from apartments that literally when the front door was open, you could not get in. You had to crawl over 5 feet of materials to get into the apartment, to less cluttered but still serious issues. It's a legal issue and it's a social issue. I think that's why it's important to be discussing this, because again, more and more, we're all dealing with this issue. If you have questions for me or you want to comment, just raise your hand again. Let's try to be as interactive as we can. If I don't know the answer, I clearly will be able to make it up. I'm a very good lawyer. Let's talk about what is hoarding. When does collecting become hoarding? I went antiquing with my wife recently, and we went into a store that sold antiques and collectibles. Right? And I realized after spending way too many hours walking through these stores that collecting to me was stuff I had in my basement. Right? If I had it in my basement, we were collecting. If it was valuable and high priced, it was an antique. Right? It's very hard to sometimes look at when someone's just collecting things and when it's getting to a hoarding level. So let's start by looking at these pictures. If you look at the packet, you'll see a series of pictures. And again, these are real pictures of real tenants' apartments that we were in. And they're numbered down at the bottom. So picture number one. I'll hold up the color picture because it maybe does a little more justice. Would anyone think that this is not hoarding? Number one, yes, hoarding. Okay.
Not yet.
Not yet?
It's organized.
Okay. It's organized, right? Very well organized. Everything's in boxes. Radiators are blocked, right? If you look in the corner of the radiator. And the window is blocked, right? Maybe you can't see it, but in the left-hand corner, that's the window. Okay, so we may disagree on whether that's hoarding or not. Look at the next picture, number two. You know, again, same apartment. Very well organized, right? But a lot of the stuff. What do you see in the background? You see to the top right corner, a lot of wires, exposed wires there. But how many people think that is we have a hoarding situation here? How many don't think so? Okay, so we're looking a little more towards hoarding. Let's look at the next picture. So this is actually the kitchen. Right now, this client, it's one of the housing authorities, has a major issue with hoarding because it's a suburban housing authority, and very, very, very small apartments. I mean, you walk in, little living room, galley kitchen, little bedroom, bathroom, that's it. And a lot of the people that are moving in to these properties are moving out of a house, right? So they're moving from a house where they had four bedrooms, kitchen, downstairs, and they're moving everything into this one room, right? Here we have the stove covered in plastic and paper, right? That white thing there is a stove, we have almost no pathway through there. How many people agree we got hoarding now?
Yeah.
Right? Okay. How many don't think this is hoarding? Okay. So now that's one apartment. Now the next series of photos. Again, this apartment is what I would call subsumed with property. That's my nice fancy word for it, right? That is a room, right? And there's no visible floor. There's no way to circumnavigate that apartment, right? If you turn the page, this is her kitchen. No ability to navigate through that area. If you turn to the next page, I labeled the door. So this is the second means of egress from this apartment. You'll take my word for it that is a door. That's a problem. We're looking at hoarding, right? The next page is the other back door, which there's a sheet over. Okay? So would everyone agree that they would think this apartment is hoarding, right? Let's turn to the next page. Is this hoarding? So apparently, we're a Star Wars fan. Clean, right? A lot of the stuff. Probably more just a collector than hoarding, right? What if that was a window behind the shelving? Does that create hoarding? So we're going to talk about that a little bit. Next page. This is actually my basement. No, I'm kidding. Person clearly collects cans, hopefully of empty beer. But it's a basement. And that's one of the windows, right? So clearly that window is being blocked. Hoarding? Not hoarding? Collecting? Okay. The next page is actually from the internet, and I thought it was kind of cute. You know, if you can't read it, it says a two-year-old is kind of like having a blender, but you don't have a top for it. And that is actually what my basement looks like. I told my daughter I was going to take a picture of her room and slip it in to see if anybody thought it was hoarding. And she came to me last night and she said, "Dad, you want to take a picture? My room's back to hoarding stage." And I said, "Oh, honey, I'm so proud of you. I'm so proud of you." All right. So what's my point? My point is that, again, you look at those pictures, And sometimes it's not easy to understand whether someone's hoarding, whether it is hoarding, and when you get to that point. So I wanted to start by talking a little bit about what the definition of hoarding is. So first of all, the fourth edition of the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, the DSM, is now being published. There's a new one coming out. And this is the book that sort of allows professionals to make a diagnosis of a mental health disability. And there's a debate going on right now as to whether hoarding is of itself a diagnosis, or is it just part of an overall diagnosis of OCD, of obsessive compulsive disorder. And that hasn't been decided yet, according to the people I spoke to. It's interesting to know, what percent of the population do you think has OCD? What do you think? Hopefully not 50%. 10 of the of the U.S. population, 2 to 3% of the population actually suffer from OCD. That's a lot if you think about it. That's a large number of people that have obsessive compulsive disorder, and about a third of those people actually exhibit hoarding behavior. Okay, so again, that's a large number of people that are out there that have both OCD and hoarding. Now, it seems like hoarding is just a new issue, something that's just been coming up more recently, but I actually found a great quote. I'm going to read it to you. This is sort of our educational part of the seminar. This will be very highbrow of us here. This is from Dante's Inferno in the 14th century. Okay, that was a while ago. I'm going to read it to you. It says, "Here, too, I saw a nation of lost souls, far more than were above. They strained their chests against enormous weights and with mad howls rolled them at one another. Then in haste they rolled them back, one party shouting out, 'Why do you hoard?' And the other, 'Why do you waste?' Hoarding and squandering wasted all their light and brought them screaming to the brawls of wraths. You need no words of mine to grasp their plight." Okay, so clearly, 14th century, there was hoarding, because Dante is talking about that. Interesting, talking about both the person that's hoarding and the hoarding person saying, "Why do you people waste?" Very, very interesting. And we all know that hoarding doesn't just relate to property, right? Hoarding can also relate to animals. I had the pleasure of dealing with the infamous cat lady in Boston, who had 30, 40, 50 cats in her apartment. And you can only imagine the squalor in that apartment. I had the extreme pleasure of going into that apartment with the judge, with a forensic person with a blue light, that shows urine. And we stood in the bathroom, and the guy turned off the light, turned on the blue light, and the entire room glowed. At that point, I felt the judge literally like standing on top of me. He was like pressing into me, and I knew he would learn his lesson never to do a view of an apartment. But obviously, those create sanitary issues and other issues when we're dealing with live animals. So hoarding is actually defined as having three components. Number one, the acquisition of and failure to discard a large number of possessions that appear to be useless or of limited value. Okay, now appear to us, right, because as we're going to talk about, does not appear to the hoarder that they are useless or of limited value. Number two, the living space is cluttered enough that they can't be used for the activity for which they were designed. Okay, so actually, hoarding can also take place in a motor vehicle. I was in court on Friday with a hoarder, and I happened to walk by their car and had to alert the judge to the fact that their car was such that it was inoperable. Okay, it was so full of personal property. It was scary. And thirdly, significant distress or impaired functioning because of the hoarding. So one thing I think is important to note is that the hoarder doesn't have any distress. Very rarely are they in distress because they're not seeing the problem, right? This is not a problem to them. So it's not that they're having distress, it's distress or impaired functioning. And clearly, someone suffering from hoarding is having impaired functioning. Hoarding usually has three components. Number one, acquiring possessions compulsively. So for example, compulsively buying or collecting free items. Okay. Two, saving these possessions and never discarding them. Right? So to remove an item from the apartment is a travesty. It cannot be accomplished by most hoarders. And third, not organizing and maintaining all the saved possessions. Now, sometimes, as we saw in the pictures, hoarders can be extremely organized, right? That's part of the OCD component of this, right? Everything is very well organized and documented. Hoarders can be extremely clean, right? Everything is spotless. It's just subsumed in the amount of clean items. And there are many reasons people hoard. One being sentimental value, right? An emotional attachment. These things bring back memories of the good old days. Pictures, newspapers, right? I need that newspaper because it reminds me of these things. I need all these items because they remind me of things. The second being a utility value. The item is or someday could be used for something important. It may come back and be needed. I had a case where I was actually a guardian ad litem, appointed by the court for a hoarder in Brockton. He had every newspaper, every phone book for 30 years stacked up in his apartment. Every phone book. And I said to him, Carl, why, I'll use his first name, not his last name, Carl, why do you need these phone books? Can we put these out now? Oh no, I may need them. I may need to call somebody. How will I get in touch with them if I don't have this phone book from 1972? And it didn't matter to him that, I could explain to him that person likely didn't live there anymore. There was the internet now, all these other ways of doing it. No, this had a real value. He also would save every paper towel he used, right? So he would use a paper towel, and then he would put it on the stove to dry, right? Because that had a value. That, why would you buy more paper towel if you could just keep using the same paper towel over and over again? Class notes from high school, I had those in my basement. We had a flood. I believe that the key to not hoarding is having a good flood in your basement every couple of years. I had my law school notes, and my wife had her nursing notes from 30 years ago, and probably we didn't need those anymore, but it took a good flood to get rid of those. The next is an aesthetic value. This is too beautiful to throw away. Oh, this is so gorgeous. This painting or this picture or something else is just so beautiful, I could never get rid of it. And the last one that I would add, and this is my own, is a monetary value. A lot of hoarders now are compulsive shoppers, right? Carl, who I was talking about, was a compulsive shopper. He had about 50 extra large T-shirts in the bag, stacked up in one corner. And when I asked him why, he said, "Well, they were 99 cents." I said, "Well, Carl, you're about 5'1". You weigh about 100 pounds, but they were 99 cents. Tuna fish cans. He had hundreds of cans of tuna fish because they were 25 cents. He didn't eat tuna fish, right? But he had to have these tuna fish cans because they were such a good buy. So it's sort of the BJ's syndrome, right? It's a great buy. So is anybody at this point saying, boy, I think I fall into this category or one of these categories, right? I like to go to BJ's. I like to get all these things. The difference is hoarders apply this to everything in their apartment, right? There is no being able to differentiate between the things that are valuable and not valuable, where we hopefully can do that, right? Everything in the apartment has one of these characteristics such that it can't be removed. And again, as part of the OCD diagnosis, many hoarders have extremely clean apartments, very well organized chaos. It's chaos, but it's organized chaos, because the issue for a lot of them is control, right? Wanting to be able to control their environment. The items can't be touched because they'll lose control. The apartment that I was talking about, that when you walked in the door, literally 4 feet, 5 feet up was newspaper, and you had to crawl over into the apartment. When we went to remove the items by court order, and we'll talk about that later, this woman literally had a nervous breakdown that we were touching anything in that apartment. Because once she lost control, that was it. That was what was holding her together, okay? So it's really a control issue. And they need to know where everything is. And they know where everything is. You know, growing up, I'm going to tell a lot of stories, but it makes it a little more interesting. Growing up, my best friend's mother was a hoarder. Didn't know it then, know it now. She hoarded outrageously expensive antiques, right? I grew up in Fairfield, Connecticut. This was a very wealthy family. And slowly, as I grew up with my friend, the house became more and more filled with these extremely valuable antiques everywhere, on the floor, to the point where you really couldn't walk into most of the house by the time we graduated high school. And he went back as an adult to try to start removing things because it got to the point that it really, A, wasn't safe, but B, he was really concerned that some of these items were outrageously expensive antiques and there was no way if there was a fire that anything was going to be insured. And he took a couple of the items. Now again, imagine these rooms just filled with antiques. He took a few of them. She immediately noticed that they were missing. She knew exactly where everything was and immediately was like, where is the vase from 1872 that was in that corner over there? None of us could see it. But in her mind, she knew where everything was. So I think it's important to understand that and understand that a lot of people suffering with hoarding are perfectionists. So we might think that they just are crazy, there's so much stuff in there, how can they be dealing with this? A lot of them have to keep organizing it, have to rearrange it every day to get it reorganized, and that's part of the issue, okay? The real issue is someone suffering from hoarding doesn't see an issue, right? To say to a hoarder, clean your house, clean your apartment, right? To them, it is clean. There's nothing to do. They will agree to do it, but then do nothing because there is no problem. If you say, remove the clutter, right? You need to remove the clutter by Thursday or else. Again, to someone suffering from hoarding, they don't see that there is clutter. They will be offended by that, and they can't address it because there is no clutter. In their mind, there is no clutter. So to use general terms like that really doesn't work for someone in this situation because, again, they're not seeing the issue. If they saw the issue, they would probably deal with it. The fact that they cannot physically get into their apartment anymore, they don't see that as an issue. As I mentioned, I think hoarding's been around since the start of time. You know, the cavemen likely had too many pelts in their cave or something. I think there's one of the comics I put in deals with this. And a lot of people ask, well, why is this suddenly such a problem? A lot of property managers, 10 years ago, we weren't dealing with hoarding. We really weren't. I mean, we'd have one every now and then. Now it's really a huge problem, and we wonder why. Why has it suddenly become such a problem? And I don't know. Some people say less social services out there, right? The deinstitutionalization of people. There's a lot more mental health, I think, on the street now than I saw 20 years ago or 25 when I started practicing law. We weren't dealing with it so often. I think there are a lot less services for these people out there because of budget issues and all of that. It's I represent all landlords, so I'm the cold, heartless landlord lawyer, right? And yet, believe it or not, I do have a heart sometimes. And it's heartbreaking sometimes to see these people who are sort of just out there. And from the landlords, the property managers out there would tell you they don't know what to do because they're just property managers. And yet, often it becomes incumbent on them to suddenly be trying to deal with these issues because there's no one else out there. There's no family, right? Especially in public housing a lot, there's no family. There's no emergency contact. These people are out on their own. They may not have access to health care. These property managers, many of whom have a college degree, but probably took Psych 101, and that was about it, really don't have the knowledge or the skills to deal with these situations, and yet they've sort of become the forefront of the problem. I guess I'll leave that to the academics as to why this is a greater problem. I don't know if any of you have any ideas, but I don't know why.
Well, I think Probably because we're looking for it more. It's like child abuse or elder abuse. Mm-hmm. It wasn't around, so you started looking for it, you find there's a lot more.
Right. I mean, I will say in public housing and landlord-tenant law, we're always in people's apartments. So we were seeing it if it was there. I mean, it used to be that, you know, if we had a problem, we would call the police or we'd call an ambulance, they'd get taken away and they'd be gone. And now, you know, a lot of it is that just people with untreated mental health issues are put into these apartments by themselves with nothing else out there. So I want to talk about, you know, so we talked about what is hoarding, right? We looked at those pictures and we all sort of said, is it, is it not? We talked a little about these definitions out there as to all the components and all of that. And that's all well and good and very interesting. And what I want to talk a little bit about is what do we use when we try to decide, is someone hoarding or are they not? I mean, obviously somebody living in their home or in their apartment has a right to live as they want, right? They have certain civil liberties and, you know, and we're not going to micromanage how someone wants to live. So when I get a call from a client and I get these pictures emailed to me and I open them up, I use the following analysis to decide whether or not I think it's a hoarding issue or whether it's just a lot of stuff and we're going to let it go. I ask myself the following question. I ask myself if a firefighter or other emergency personnel had to go into that apartment in a fire, right, in their full firefighter's gear. So they've got an oxygen tank on, they've got a mask on, it's dark, it's smoky, and there's no lights, right, because the power's out. Are they going to be able to safely circumnavigate that apartment or that home? Are they going to be able to get in there? Because we all know from the Worcester fire tragedy, they're going to go in, right? It's their job. They're not going to say, wow, this apartment is really messy. We'll go to the next apartment, right? They're going to go in, they're going to do a search. Can they get around that apartment safely, or are they going to fall down and get injured, right? That's sort of the test that I start with. Is it safe to navigate this apartment or not? Can a medical team get a stretcher in, right? If we need to get in and get this person out, can they get a stretcher in? That's the first thing I look at, as to whether or not I think there's a hoarding issue that we need to deal with. The second issue I look at is there a potential for fire or other threat to safety of a resident, this resident, or other residents? So things like extension cords, right? So we were looking at those pictures, we saw all those extension cords out there. That's a potential fire issue. Paper on the stove or near heaters, right? So Carl drying all his paper towels on the stove, that was a life safety issue that created a problem. Is there so much stuff that in a fire, the apartment's just going to go up in flames? Is it just the volume of paper in there? And are the access points blocked, right? Can you get to the window? Can you get through every door? In an emergency. So that's another big factor that we're looking at, because again, what this really comes down to is a life safety issue, right? Is this a threat to the resident? Is this a threat to others? I add on top of that a major issue, which is, do they smoke, right? Because when you add that into the equation, that's a whole nother factor that's really going to endanger someone. If they are smoking and there's just that volume of personal property, you're asking for a problem. A couple months ago, we actually had a resident whose apartment was extremely cluttered up on the North Shore, fell asleep with a cigarette, died in their apartment. Apartment was destroyed. Very, very concerning. So those are the sort of the factors that I look at when I decide whether or not we've got a hoarding issue. If the person can safely get around their apartment, I may ask them to clean it up, I may start working with them, but it's not, to me, an emergent issue. If there's no fire safety issue, again, I may err on the side of giving them a little more leeway. Once it gets to the point where a firefighter can't get through, a stretcher can't get through, or there's a potential for fire, we're going to go to the next step. We're going to call it hoarding and we're going to go on. There's also liability issues for landlords, and we look at it that way because once a landlord knows of this issue, if there's then a fire and something happens, is my client going to get sued for negligence, especially by the neighbors, right? We knew of the problem and we didn't take any action. You know, bad enough Channel 7 is going to show up at the door and say, what did you do? You know, that's bad enough. But I always tell my clients, think about sitting in a deposition. Any of you had the pleasure of being in a deposition? It's a lovely thing to be a witness in a deposition. And having that lawyer ask you that great question. Once you knew of these horrible conditions, what did you do to prevent a fire? And do you say, well, I sent a warning letter, or did you try to do something more? So that's the mindset that a lot of property owners are looking at it. I would say to some extent, I know it when I see it. You know, when I look at pictures, I get a little more jaded now, having done this for so long. I know it when I see it. But a lot of clients will think something's hoarding and it's not. It's just a little more messy than they're used to. Okay? Questions so far? Comments? Concerns?
Say, yep, you're right. This is the definition of hoarding. They're hoarding. Therefore, you got to remove these items. I'm a housing inspector in the town of Boston, right, Massachusetts, registered sanitarian. I've been in houses where I think there is hoarding. I'm not a psychologist.
Yeah.
They are hoarding. They can use their kitchen. They can use their bathroom. Their egresses are not blocked. And is it safe? Is open for interpretation? In a court of law, can do you in your practices go after people just saying they're hoarding when there's no violations of the state sanitary code, as I just stated?
So we're going to talk in a little while about the state sanitary code and some of the legal issues. I will tell you there is no definition of hoarding. There's a diagnosis of it, but It definitely is something that is subjective, right? There's no objective as long as you have, you know, people will say to me, well, if I have 3-foot pathways everywhere and nothing higher than, you know, 2 feet high, is that okay, you know, as a matter of law? And there is no definition, there is no black letter law on this is okay, this is not. There's a state sanitary code that we'll talk about, but as you all know, the state sanitary code is somewhat subject to interpretation, right? I mean, it imbues you with discretion. And you've all used your discretion as to whether something is necessarily a violation or not, whether it's a violation that materially endangers the health, safety, and well-being of the occupant or not. And you know, judges also use their discretion. So we'll talk about that in a minute. Usually what I say is if I don't know the answer, I say we'll get to that. And then we don't get to it ever. You know, that's the key. But we actually will get to that. Okay.
Rob Sands, the Harwich Fire Department. It's interesting that I've been here 28 years, and we use pretty much the same criteria that you just mentioned, kind of your guidelines, if you will. So on our end, either a neighbor will call and they're concerned about fire safety or an apartment complex, or we'll go in there on a medical, which is usually the case. We'll go in there on a medical and we'll happen to notice, you know, we can't get through, you know, all the things that you mentioned. And while we're there, we have the legal power to stay there, and they can't throw us out. So while we're there, we'll call a deputy, we'll make certain calls, and we'll make the most of our legal authority to stay there, you know, to clear, to look at the wires, the smoke detectors, are they smoking, all those things. Because what we found is, I'm sure you realize, once we leave, we can't go back in unless we get a court order. So we'll tend to stay there as long as we can and make the most of our time. But I just interesting to let you know we use the same criteria that you just met. So
yeah,
it's good for us to hear that we're doing the doing the same thing anymore, same right. criteria.
Good, good, okay. Other questions? Yep.
So just a follow-up is, one of the questions that we've had quite often is, if EMS does go in on a medical issue and they notice a hoarding an issue and there's concern there, are there HIPAA regulations that limit what they're allowed to share with other agencies?
No, I'll really still get to that because I'm not an expert on HIPAA. Yeah, I don't know. I'm not familiar with it. I mean, I'm familiar with it, but not by any stretch of the imagination. But I don't think there's a HIPAA restriction on calling another agency in for a known violation. I don't think you're disclosing the person's medical condition or anything about them. You're just disclosing there's a condition in an apartment that needs to be inspected.
The usual rule is if it's part of an ongoing investigation, you know, whether it's armed robbery or whatever, and you disclose the minimal amount of information necessary as part of the ongoing investigation, as long as it's an official agency, that's compliant with HIPAA. The neighbor comes over and says, hey, you've been here for 4 hours, what's the reason for it? That may be a different story, okay? But now there's no, if you need to call any official agency as part of the investigation, then you just do it.
Yeah, I wouldn't think that would come within HIPAA because you're not saying, hey, this person has, HIV and, their apartment's messy. You're just saying, hey, I went in, this apartment's in right. an unsanitary condition, yeah. The same as if you went in and saw, there's a building issue, there's no fire smoke right. detectors, the porch seems to be falling off. You'd probably call in the building inspector. So, right. Did you have a comment in the back?
Yeah, question. What happens when you've lost the window that the fire inspector refers to? What's the best procedure?
So we're going to talk about that.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're going to talk about your ability to access, your rights to access under the state sanitary code and the codes and have a discussion on that because I don't think it's so clear from the state sanitary code. Let's now talk, so we talked about, sort of what is hoarding, how do we know if it's hoarding, and again, when it comes down to it, I always say I know it when I see it, because, especially if I see it, because once you get to a certain point, you're so jaded that you if it's not that bad, there's every phone book since 1972, but they're in the corner, it's okay. Some property owners get really worried about it more than probably they necessarily have to. So I want to talk about the legal issues with hoarding now. Again, for some of you, this may not be relevant, but I think it's a good thing to understand because it may help you understand the a property owner's response to hoarding. One of the first issues that we always face when we're dealing with somebody that's hoarding is fair housing and reasonable accommodations. And so I briefly wanted to talk about reasonable accommodation law and what sometimes the landlord has to do before they can take action. Find the right notes. Good question. Okay. Did anyone steal my reasonable accommodation notes? Give me 1 second because I know I had them. So reasonable accommodations. So there's several federal and state laws dealing with a right to a reasonable accommodation. I'm not going to go into them because you don't need to know them. But generally want to talk about what a property owner is required to do in relation to somebody that has a disability. So the property owner is required to make what's called a reasonable accommodation. Every statute that uses the word reasonable is wonderful for lawyers because it leads to a lot of litigation over that. We like vague statutes, but what is reasonable we're going to talk about. So a reasonable accommodation to a disabled resident which is necessary to afford them equal access and enjoyment of their property. So if you break that down, the first issue we always have is whether or not somebody is actually disabled. And a disability is a physical or mental impairment which substantially limits one or more major life functions. Or the person is has a record of such an impairment, or, and this is my favorite one, is regarded of having such an impairment. So for property owners, we always have to start with, well, is this person really have a disability or not? And so how does this come up? Well, sometimes we know the person has a disability as a landlord. Maybe they're receiving SSDI, which means that they have a record of having a disability. Maybe they're in a building that only is for disabled people, so we know that they're disabled. Number two is it could be they're regarded as being disabled, and that's a really tough one for property owners because for some disabilities, it's obvious, right? If the person is wearing hearing aids, I can see that they may have a hearing impairment. If they're using a walker with a red tip, I know they're disabled. I can look at them and say they probably have a disability. The disabilities that we're talking about are mental health disabilities. Those are hard to see, right? I look at you, you look fine. But you may have, if you're hoarding, I don't know if it's a mental disability or not. So that's always the first thing that we have to look at. The second thing we look at is whether the person, there's a connection between this disability and what the person is requesting. It's called a nexus. Whether there's some nexus between that request and what they are, and their disability, a connection there. And next we look at whether there's, this is required to give them equal access and enjoyment. Not better, but equal use and enjoyment of their properties. So these are sort of the analysis that we're doing. Now for most property owners, we're going to follow a system where we're going to give the person a right to their reasonable accommodation, and they're going to give us a doctor's letter saying whether they're disabled, right, whether they're handicapped. And we're just going to accept that because most landlords are not going to question that. The issue that comes up with fair reasonable accommodations in relation to hoarding is, well, what's the request? What are they asking us to change? What policy or procedure are they asking us to change here in order to grant them that equal access and enjoyment of their property, right? A reasonable accommodation doesn't just mean we'll leave it the way it is, right? Because that's not equal access, right? That's better access, right? Everybody needs to keep their apartment in a safe condition. What we're looking at is there something we can do to enable them to continue to reside here in a safe manner? And what could that be? Well, that could be, I'm starting to take my medication. Give me a chance to take my medication. It could be developing a plan to remove the hoarding. And that's what we're going to be looking at, whether there's some alteration that we can make that, again, allows the apartment to be returned to a safe condition, but also make sure that the apartment is safe. Okay. So for most landlords, the first thing that we're getting hit with is, what accommodation do we need to make? I included a case, the Bridgewater case, BHA versus Bridgewater, which is sort of the leading case in fair housing, reasonable accommodation law. And that was a case in Boston where a resident of the Boston Housing Authority physically assaulted his twin brother on the property, actually beat the guy almost to death, put him in a wheelchair. It was a horrible, horrible incident. And the BHA, as they should, took action to remove the person, right? Filed a court case, went to court, and had a trial. And just as the trial was ending, literally, as the judge was walking off the bench, the tenant said, oh, and by the way, I'm bipolar. And the judge said, too late. We already had the trial done. BHA said, no, we're done. You know, we're not doing anything here. The case went up to the appeals court. We got a great decision from the appeals court saying that, no, you weren't entitled to an accommodation. Case went up to the Supreme Judicial Court, and they reversed. And what they said is that no matter where you are in the process with this resident, you still have to follow your policies and procedures in relation to granting reasonable accommodations. Whether it's at the end of the case, whether it's at the beginning of the case, you still have to afford them that right no matter where you are. Okay, the court didn't say that that person was entitled to an accommodation, right? There may have been no accommodation to give somebody who physically assaults another resident on the property to that extent. But you at least have to consider it. You at least have to look into it. And that sort of created a dilemma for many landlords because now, even when we see these unsafe apartments, we still need to consider what accommodation we can grant them at this point. there's an exception to reasonable accommodation law, and that's for a direct threat to the safety of other people, right? And that probably would have been an exception in the Bridgewater case, right? And that's often an exception that we use in hoarding cases, that this person is a direct threat to our other residents. But even in those cases, you still have to consider what else is out there that might enable this person to comply. Even if you think they're now a direct threat, what could help them? Have they changed their medication? Do they now have services in place? Is there something we can use to address this in a way short of eviction, right? But reasonable accommodation law is not that you just simply ignore it, because that's normally the request we get. I'm disabled. I need an accommodation. The accommodation I want is just let me live this way, right? That's not reasonable, okay? That's not an accommodation, okay? So that's sort of my, yes?
Could you give a couple of examples of a direct threat as opposed to an indirect threat?
So a direct threat would be, you stabbed someone on the property. You killed someone on the property. You started a fire on the property. You are a direct threat to the safety of the other residents. That would be an example of a direct threat.
And so hoarding is not necessarily a direct threat, then?
It would depend on the hoarding, right?
If,
and the thing about...
It poses a fire risk to other people in the building. Is that considered a direct threat?
To me, yes. If you're hoarding, but you're not... it's not threatening anyone, to me, that's probably not a direct threat. But an apartment that has paper on the stove, that has paper piled up in front of the heaters, that to me is a direct threat to the safety of the other residents. But again, under fair housing law, you still would have to consider whether there is some reasonable way of accommodating that person. There may not be. Right, and Bridgewater stands for the position that you have to at least consider it, follow your process and procedures. It may be that there is none, but if the person were to say, "Well, listen, I'm going to take, I'm taking my new medication. I'm now working with a heavy chore person, and I'm doing cognitive behavioral therapy now. It's going to help me with my OCD. Maybe then." There is, even though they were a direct threat, there's a way to accommodate that person anyway. You can't just say, forget about it, you're a direct threat, get out.
And what about a direct threat to oneself? If, for example, all of those behaviors were going on, the paper on the stove, et cetera, but it was a private residence and there was no one else?
I think there's still a direct threat, and here's why. Number one, they're a direct threat to themselves, but they are a direct threat to others, right? The firefighter that goes in there, find that person, and it's a threat to them. It's a threat to any life safety people, any public safety officials that are going to be in there. It's a direct threat to all of you, right? Because you're going into these apartments, right? Someone was mentioned before that you're going to have another topic on protecting yourself when you go into these apartments, right? I like to say I don't do site visits. I've been in one apartment for an eviction in my whole career. I don't have to go in. I don't know how people do it. You know, you go in not knowing what's behind that door. So that's a great topic to be discussing at a later date, how you protect yourself. But I think it is a direct threat. Okay, I guess the point I would make is it's really a case-by-case analysis. You really have to look at each case individually. How much stuff is there? What is the threat? How easily is it to remove that threat? Right? Is this just a case where it's removing everything from within 3 feet of the stove? Or is it beyond that? Right? Okay. Yeah.
Say a landlord would be, right? But how about a lot of the people in this room who are code enforcement officials? I mean, if there's a code that says, you can't do this, right?
I don't believe that.
Impose an obligation on a code enforcement official to.
I do not believe so, because you're not the landlord, you're not the property owner, you're a public official. And so I don't believe you have an obligation to reasonably accommodate the person in their home. And again, the fact that there's the code is the law, and it's not reasonable to, you can't waive the state sanitary code, right? That's clear. You can't waive the building code. So you have an obligation to enforce that. So it wouldn't be reasonable to, we get that all the time, can you reasonably accommodate me by ignoring the code, right? And we all know you can't. So it comes up a lot in my practice with minimal occupancy standards, right? 50 square feet per person per bedroom, or 70, then 50, right? And people have another kid. And the landlord will say, hey, you know, you can't live here anymore. You now exceed the state sanitary code. And they say, well, can't you just waive that? And they can't, right? We'd like to, nice family, right? But we can't because we have an obligation to comply with the state sanitary code. Yep.
That being said, we've had experience, I'm a lawyer from the town of Barnstable, with the fair housing folks in Boston, where if there's a variance procedure with the Board of Health reg, they have argued that that would be a reasonable accommodation to grant a variance in certain circumstances. I think it depends upon the code you're dealing with, you know, in terms of, you know, what you're protecting. But I was surprised to hear that as well, that,
yeah,
you know, the fact that you vary under certain circumstances.
Right, and clearly, I presume it would be an issue of what part of the code you're asking for, right? For example, the minimum occupancy standards, I think, is a life safety issue, right? How many people can safely live in an apartment?
It wasn't that exact issue.
Really? I mean, to me, if it was something like, you know, I mean, there's very obscure parts of the code about, you know, how much ambient light has to come in and that sort of thing, you know, I could see that being something that's not really affecting the safety of a person. Whereas, to me, that provision does.
And we argued that we've never waived it for anybody, and I think that was enough to persuade them that
right.
That wasn't something, you know, if we had been more flexible with everybody. So that's
right. It's those crazy legal services lawyers. I only say that because someone's spouse is one of the legal services lawyers. So. okay. So oftentimes in the reasonable accommodation realm, the issue that we're having is what resources are available, right? What we can do to accommodate the person, because it really takes resources, and often there aren't resources. So, you know, one resource that is often needed is treatment, right? Helping with dealing with the symptoms and the compulsions. But as a property owner and as a town official, you don't have the ability, A, to force someone to do that. No one has the ability to force someone to seek medical care. And second of all, you probably don't have the resources to necessarily refer them to any certain provider. So that becomes a real issue because the person will say, I need an accommodation, but there is no, from the medical side, it's very hard to know how you get somebody to go see a doctor and then to comply with the prescription that they're taking. My experience is often, even when they get prescribed the medication, they're not taking it because they don't see the problem, right? They don't see the behavioral issue, so or they start taking it and they don't like it and then they stop. And it's very hard to then know if someone is actually taking their medication or not, right? We've had cases where as part of an agreement we've required somebody to actually take their medication in front of a provider every day. And that's great, right? And that's great from our point of view, but good luck getting a provider that will come in every day to watch someone take their medication, right? The real issue we have is that you need action here, right? You need someone to come in and do the work. You need somebody that can actually come in and do heavy chores. You know, last week I was in court with a hoarder with bed bugs, and we're going to talk about that added component of bed bugs. And she had no ability to address the issue. She totally had no cognitive ability and no physical ability to move the items that she needed to move. She not only did she not see the issue, but you know, we said you need to start carrying stuff out, and you know she couldn't lift items, and she couldn't afford a storage unit, right? So there's no place to put the items, you know she'd been offered treatment, she'd never accepted it, and she needed someone to go in and with boxes and just take stuff, and there's no one there. Now, luckily for her, there's a program through the housing courts called the Tenancy Preservation Program. That we got involved, that was able to get those services. But for most of you out here, you have no housing court, right? You have the district court. You have no tenancy preservation program, and so saying, you know, where these services are, I don't know. You really end up being just hoping that there's a family member or someone in the community that will come forward to do this work. In that case, of course, we had the added pleasure of having the stuff infested with bed bugs. not only was it hard to find somebody to come take the items, but no one wanted to take items that are infested with bed bugs. And of course, we couldn't treat for the bed bugs until all the stuff was out. So we'll get to that. In the end, one of the absolute factors that comes in here is this person otherwise qualified to live in our housing? Because in the end, if they're not, they're not entitled to an accommodation, right? Some people are just so disabled that as a private landlord, we can't do anything. We just can't. We don't have the ability to do anything. That person is just not otherwise qualified to be here and probably needs some sort of more assisted living. And that comes up a lot in these cases. If we can't move the stuff out, we can't get through to them, nothing's working, we're not going to be able to give them an accommodation because they're not otherwise qualified to be here. The other legal issue that I want to talk about, again, for landlords and property owners, not so much for you all, is the negligence issue that landlords get concerned about when we see these apartments. We get very concerned that there's going to be a fire and someone's going to be injured and we're going to get sued. And that's why most landlords are going to take this very seriously once they know of that hazard. The other issue that comes up is whether or not we have an obligation to other residents to ensure their quiet enjoyment. So along with many of these apartments comes the issue of odor, right? So sometimes it's just confined to one unit, right? And it's not such a big deal. When it starts spreading, we get calls from residents, the odor is horrible. We have horror stories about people that are just, you can smell two floors away. At that point, we know of an issue. We know someone's quiet enjoyment is being affected. Question whether we have an obligation to then go in and do something about it. And most landlords are going to take the position that they do. The last issue I want to talk about, sort of as legal issues, before we get into the practical solutions, is bed bugs. How many of you had contact with bed bugs, issues with bed bugs? Yeah, it's great. When I was a child, most kids when they were growing up wanted to be like a baseball player or play for the Red Sox or go to the moon. I dreamed of someday being a bed bug expert, and my dreams came true, and I don't know how. But I am somewhat of an expert on bed bugs, and to the point where now my children like to shop at thrift shops. So none of your kids are into that. They like to go to the Goodwill and get clothing, or they go to New York City and they go to the Goodwill, they go to the thrift shops and they bring back clothing. But when they walk into my house, they'll say to me, "Dad, don't worry, I took all the clothing, I put it all in the dryer for 45 minutes on high heat." So the fact that my kids know, like, without being told, what the bed bug protocol is a little scary. We all know about bed bugs. We all know they can live a year without eating. We all know that they're attracted to heat, the human body. They like women more than men because women's body temperature is a little higher than men. So that's good news for all the guys out there. Some people aren't allergic to bed bugs, right? So what a bed bug does is it bites, it sucks the blood out, it injects its saliva into the person. That causes an allergic reaction for some people. Some people it doesn't, right? Some people have bed bugs and never know it. Some people are horribly allergic to bed bug bites. My former nanny has had bed bugs twice. She is horribly allergic to bed bugs. And I actually, when I teach seminars on it, I bring pictures of her when she was someplace because she's covered in these red bites everywhere. What's the problem with bed bugs, right? I used to say bed bugs just had really bad PR agents. Because if you say, "Oh, there are moths in the apartment," you go, "Oh, there's moths, oh, okay." Say bed bugs, everybody starts scratching and goes crazy. And when you tell residents that there are bed bugs in the building, everybody wants to move out, right? Bed bugs don't carry any known pathogens, right? They don't cause any. If they bite you, it's not like a mosquito, right? Mosquitoes now, oh my God, right? You all know that. Mosquitoes can kill you. And yet, if you say I have mosquitoes in my backyard, okay. Bed bugs don't cause anything like that. And yet, the mention of the word bed bugs and people go berserk. Why is it such an issue? The problem with bed bugs is, as opposed to every other pest that's out there, you can't treat bed bugs without the cooperation of the tenant, right? Of the occupant, right? A cockroach, you're the exterminator, they don't like to be called exterminators anymore, but the pest control specialist can go in and they can spray whatever around your stuff, right? You don't want to cooperate, it's fine. you can get rid of the bed bugs. Mice, rats, you can get rid of them by, you know, even if the place is pretty cluttered, you can get rid of them. Bed bugs, if the tenant does not follow that protocol to the letter, you will never get rid of the bed bugs. And we all know that protocol includes putting everything in the dryer, right? It's not washing, it's drying it, bagging everything up, right? If you take the bag full of clothing, put it in the dryer, put it back in that same bag, you've just cross-contaminated, you've still got them, right? If you leave anything untreated, the bed bugs are just gonna crawl right in there and they're gonna survive, right? So that's what makes it so difficult. Add that to a cluttered apartment. Add that to a hoarding situation. How do you ever deal with this? And again, we talked about, you know, direct threat, right? Bed bugs are gonna spread. They are great at getting around, right? They're the hitchhikers extraordinaire. They will move into the next apartment. So you're not only endangering your stuff, you're not only gonna contaminate your stuff, but everybody else is gonna get them. And there's nothing we're gonna be able to stop it. The other issue is with a lot of hoarders, they like to bring stuff back into their apartment, right? They like to collect. Used furniture is a huge source of bed bugs. You probably all aware in Boston, they have an initiative during, you know, August, September, about leaving used furniture outside. A lot of students are moving in, and the city goes out in force to try to tell people, don't be bringing in this stuff. They actually go around with spray paint, and they spray paint all the furniture that's on the street to try to tag it so you don't want it, because it just contaminates every other building in the area. It becomes a major issue for when we're dealing with a hoarding situation. Bedbugs don't go, it's not clean or unclean. It's like, remember lice? It was like, oh, you're so dirty, you have lice. And my kids have had lice all the time from camp. And I like to think they're pretty clean. Same thing with bedbugs. They don't pick, it's not socioeconomic. It's not clean, unclean. It is just, they get into the apartment and then it's a huge problem. So I want to talk a little bit now about, well, what are the solutions? What are the practical solutions for dealing with that? Before I do that, we've been going for about an hour and 20 minutes. Why don't we take a quick break so people can stretch their legs, get another cup of coffee, give us like... Okay. Such a beautiful day. I feel like we should go outside and have outdoor recess. So we've talked a little bit about what is hoarding. We've talked a little bit about some of the legal issues that we face. Let's talk some practical solutions. So again, it would be easy to say to the person, hey, clean up, right? But we know that doesn't work. And it'd be easy to say to them, hey, get rid of all the clutter. Right, but we know that that doesn't work. We can't do that. A, it's not going to be an effective resolution. We have fair housing issues. From a landlord's point of view, most landlords say to me, hey, we're in the business of housing people, not removing people. And then there's always the moral issue, right? I know it's hard to believe a lawyer is saying that, but we've got the moral issue of, you know, we want to help people. We want to try to enable this person to live someplace and to deal with these issues. On the other hand, we have to get this resolved or one way or another, or we have to take some action. We can't just ignore the problem. How we respond to some extent is gonna depend on the severity of the issue. There are some cases where, I'm gonna jump to the last part of this discussion, sort of step Z. And there are other cases where, you can take a little bit longer to try to proceed with this, and we can sort of ease into the process. It's really a case-by-case basis, and again, there's no right or wrong answer here. This is the part of this discussion that I hope will be a discussion, okay? Because actually during the break, some of you came up to me with some interesting issues and questions and ideas, I hope we can share those ideas and what's worked for you and what hasn't worked for you. So to me, the first step that we always take is to meet with the tenant, meet with the occupant, and discuss the issue. Because to me, the first step is getting an understanding of, does this person understand what's going on? Are they able to address it, either physically or cognitively? Are they able to address the issue at all? That's number one. I really want to get a sense of that. Number two is, I want to see what services may already be in place. Does the resident have, or the occupant have, family, right? Now, unfortunately, oftentimes they don't. But if they do, is this just a case where I need to call the daughter in and say, hey, you need to get in and see what's going on in mom's place, because it's out of control. Or will they help? You know, a lot of times, unfortunately, we hear, oh, I've been dealing with my mother for 20 years on this, and there's nothing I can do. A lot of them also sometimes are concerned that they're going to get stuck with mom, right? From the landlord's point of view, we get that all the time. We see the biggest issue is they do not want mom coming to live with them. They want them in that apartment, and they will do whatever it takes to keep them there, regardless of whether it's the best thing for that person. And we deal with that a lot, where we're looking at it as this is just inappropriate housing for this person, and whoever we're dealing with just wants them in there. You know, what services does this person have? Are there mental health services already in place that aren't being accessed properly? Have they been terminated from those services, and why? A lot of times we find that, you know, they were with some agency, but they got terminated for some reason. And sometimes it's as easy as they just need to get back in touch with them. Sometimes they were terminated for behavioral issues. Why did that happen? And also, I need to know, have they rejected services? You know, a lot of times there are the services available, they just aren't accepting them. And if that's the case, you know, we need to understand that. We look at what social services are available. So that's something you all have to learn for your individual communities. In the jurisdictions that have a housing court, which for you is probably, you know, Plymouth County does, it's probably the closest to the Cape, they have this program called the Tenancy Preservation Program. Trained social workers who work for the court and are really there to, as the name suggests, preserve the tenancy. They don't actually provide services, but they're a great resource for those services. And whether those services are mental health care, whether it's heavy chores, whether it's getting them in touch with a doctor, they have that ability. You don't have that, which is unfortunate. But I guess something that may be a good use of this group is to talk about, you know, what services you're aware of. Have you had cases where, you know, we need somebody to go in and physically move 30 boxes of property out, and this agency did it, or this group did it? There are companies that will do it, but then the question always is, who's paying, right? We're often trying to figure out, that's our biggest sort of key, is what can we get this person in touch with? For most landlords, we often have the dilemma of, do we call the Board of Health? Do we call the town or the city to come in? And why is that a dilemma for property owners, for landlords? We get concerned of whether or not you're going to cite the landlord for the violation. So I'm inviting you and I'm asking you to come in, and you're going to cite me for a violation that I can't fix, right? That's one huge reason that we get concerned. On the other hand, what I always tell clients is, you know, you need to have a good relationship with the Board of Health or with the different agencies to be able to work with them so they understand I didn't create the issue, you should be citing them. What rights does the Board of Health have? So I think this was an issue that was brought up earlier. I said I would get to, and I will now. Can you enter without the permission of the occupant? Right. Okay, who says yes? Anyone?
Depends on the circumstance.
Okay. Well, let's look at the code. 410.820, all interior inspections shall be done in the company of the occupant or the occupant's representative. And the Board of Health shall use its best efforts to schedule and complete the inspection at a time mutually satisfactory to the occupant and the Board of Health. So it seems like the code is saying you can't go in if you're not asked without the permission of the occupant. But 105 CMR 400.100 authorizes the court to issue search warrants to the extent authorized by the state sanitary code, which is a little bit circular when you think about it, because you sort of say, okay, well, they can issue a search warrant as authorized by the state sanitary code, but the state sanitary code seems to be saying I can only go in with the occupant's permission, so do I have a right to a search warrant? Gray Boston Legal Services, I know, reads this provision of the code to mean that you cannot go in without the occupant's permission. There was actually a federal court lawsuit where Inspectional Services in Boston was going into apartments without consent. They were inspecting to find rooming houses, and my understanding is that they were doing it in a pretty military-type way. They actually had, like, flak jackets on that said ISD, and they were kind of forcing their way in to try to enforce this this law. And a consent decree was issued from the federal court saying they can't do that. But what about if it's an emergency? What if there's a direct threat and a life and safety is involved? What do you all think?
I'll give you a common scenario for us. The Board of Health knocks on the door, or VNA is coming in to do a dressing change or whatever. Person doesn't come to the door, or, you know, gives them the wave, the special wave, get out, I want to see you today. And they look through the window, and there's sparks coming out of the toaster, or the person just fell, or there's something. So they'll call police, they'll call us, and we'll arrive on the scene, and then we'll have a little discussion. And discussion is, does the information from the VNA or whoever's there warrant an immediate entry into the property? So between the police and us, if it does, and we decide there is a great potential for an immediate threat, you know, there's smoke, there's sparks, so our person's not laying there, then we'll force entry and go in.
Yep.
But that's the police and fire, and it's a different ballgame as far as the health instructor. Like I said, I work for the town of Barnesville, I'm a registered sanitarian, but me and another health inspector took a course run by the Mass Department of Public Health, Paul Affman. In the first slide they show you, there's two people on the planet that can let you in that house, the occupant or a judge with a search warrant. End of story.
So why are you different than the police and the fire? Aren't you all public safety officials?
Again, I don't know. I mean, this gentleman's saying, I don't know if their laws are different, but as a health inspector, it's drilled into our head. And in my town, I've been called to cases where the fire is like, and the police are like, oh, wait a minute, you can go in. And I'm like, no, I can't. Again, I'm not a lawyer, but it's the Fourth Amendment, isn't it?
Okay.
Of the U.S. Constitution.
Are you able to speak to big building department regulations, 780 CMR?
Yep. So I think it's very similar, right? That you.
Yeah, I think so too,
yeah.
But I may not be identical.
Yep, it is very similar as to when you can go in, but again, if you see a violation, can you go in? You wanted to.
If you see a like he had said, if you see through the window that there's a threat or a danger, then you'd have to go and apply for a search warrant for it.
Yeah.
The police are going to be able to enter for whatever our whatever extra circumstances that we can articulate. And I believe that when we're there remedying, attending to the situation of extreme circumstances, we can involve whatever resources we need to handle that, whether it be a health inspector or whatever. So I see that it's perfectly acceptable to get on the phone and say, health inspector, I need you over here right away. I see no legal issue with that.
Not according to the head of the Mass Department of Public Health.
And there is a letter from them saying it's not you're not to go in without a search warrant or the tenant's permission.
But if the police are calling them in, that's an entirely different thing. It's not a proactive thing.
Not according to the state.
Well, according to that public official's reading of the law, right?
And there's another document, I don't have it off the top of my head, that references this instance we're talking about, and it's unacceptable.
The police have a search warrant.
Right. Well, the problem is, so let's assume that there's a true fire hazard, right? And you go to apply, it's Friday afternoon, and you want to get your search warrant, you're going to have a hard time getting that from a judge until Monday, right?
I echo what the officer's saying. I've been with the Harwich Fire Department, the EMS officer of the Harwich Fire Department, for 30 years. And my understanding is that most of our power comes from the state fire marshal. So again, I echo just what he said. If we determine that it's a public threat, public safety issue, we literally, if we've been called, that's the key we're told. If somebody calls 911 and we go to the scene, legally, we own it. Now we have to justify it. You know, we have to have a legitimate reason why we would force entry in. But if we go in there and we find unexploded ordnance, grenades, I mean, anything under the sun, we have the legal authority through the state fire marshal to call any agency we deem appropriate in the interest of public safety. Do you remember that?
100%.
Yeah, we've been doing that for 30 years. Sure it does. If we deem in public safety issue, we need your authority there for advice, we do it. Sure.
So let's go on the second. Oh, go ahead.
But I really need to do, you know, a thorough inspection of this. Then they go and they ask the town attorney to get a search warrant from the court, and usually there's no problem at all.
Okay.
What I try to do when I'm called in by fire or police as a health agent is I try to, if the tenant is still there, I try to have a short conversation and explain who I am and what my role is going to be, with the ultimate desire is to get this person some assistance. But I try to introduce myself and say that any violations that I see may be documented. But I think it's a completely different situation when you're allowed entrance, as was expressed by Harwich, that they basically have control of the dwelling at that time of the emergency, rather than later.
Mm-hmm.
So while they're there and they called you in for assistance, I think that's a different situation from what's being, the question from Barnstable. It's the timing.
Right.
Being included in terms of being an expert to determine the conditions that exist and deemed to endanger. And so you can, but I always try to go that extra little bit with the conversation of the occupant. And then you do certain cover.
Now, interesting that when you read the regulation, it says in the company of the occupant, right? So at that point, you are in the company of the occupant. And I'll just be honest with you. I did a search of every housing court decision. I have that database. I didn't find any housing court decisions where it was even brought up ever of someone going in and ever being objected to in this way. But again, is it enough to be in the company of the person? There are some cases where the person's gone, right? They're on a stretcher, out there, or out the door. There are other ones where they're there and walking around and you're,
Where I go is if they're not there, I'll look in the door, I'll try to, determine without really entering the dwelling,
mm-hmm.
if there's a situation that I can, go back to later on, or perhaps, if the tenant is then medically removed, you get the permission of the owner of the property. So, it's sort of a way to hedge any violation of the entry issue.
Someone had a comment to.
I was just going to make a comment that the difference between the police and fire and when it comes to the health department is that we are administrative in our response. So they have a life safety issue where they have to deal with, and even if there's an imminent threat, our emergency powers are only come about until we give notice. So we have to provide notice either to the occupant or to the landlord, and then we can take emergency powers. But that our response is strictly administrative.
So let's,
that's the difference.
So let's go on. That leads, sort of leads to the second part of this question, which is really the, you know, well, so what? I mean, what then, right? Usually in these situations, you know, if the fire department or the police go in and they say, holy moly, right? This is just unbelievable. Boxes, papers, and you don't need to go in. You can see from the outside it is. What then? What are your powers, or what can you do then? Because again, to me oftentimes, you don't necessarily need the inspection, right? You're not going in looking at whether or not every light switch works, you know, is there a gap underneath the door, or is the bathroom vent working? You know, the fire department comes in and says, holy moly, and by the way, we took these pictures, you don't even need to go in, right? You don't need to do your full inspection. You know it. To me, the bigger issue is, what then? You know, what can you do? You have emergency powers. You just talked about that. You can condemn the property. Right, but what have you in those situations? What have you done? What do you can cite them, right? You can issue a citation. That's very nice, right? Citation has a right to appeal, right? But you've got an emergency now. You've got an apartment that, you know, unfortunately, my experience is that person is coming back rather quickly, right? They may be taken to the emergency room, and they get there, and, you know, they're okay. And they're getting run through that emergency room, and, you know, 3 hours, they're heading back to the apartment.
You took this course, I see.
It always amazes me. I go to the emergency room with my kid. I'm there for 14 hours. These people are back before, you know, the door is locked. So what has anyone had experience with, what do I do? I've got an unsafe living environment.
Ceilings were collapsing, the floors were about to collapse, the roof was leaking. I think there was 800 uneaten meals on wheels stacked throughout the place. All kinds of nasty vomits, bugs, flies, you name it. And they took her away, and you could barely even go in. The stench was unbelievable. We condemned it right then and there. Everything was, had the power disconnected. Water shut off, everything disconnected, topped the roof, boarded the windows and doors up so nobody could go in. The structure was ready to collapse, and it was definitely unfit for any human to habitate that premises at the point. We all together, police, fire, board of health, building, collaborated and agreed that we're shutting this thing down. And I believe the Board of Health agent wound up getting her elderly housing, assisted her in finding somewhere to go because she had no other family members to help her out.
Okay, so you condemned the building and you physically prohibited further occupancy.
Yeah.
Did you go in the building?
Yeah. There was structural, they caught fire, structural, the ceilings were collapsing, the floors. The roof had been leaking, must have been for 15, 20 years, and water damage, mold, unbelievable.
Right. So that's an extreme, right? And you know, we're on videotape, so you know, query always who's complaining, right? When you go in, you know, who's going to be filing this complaint saying you shouldn't have gone in? But what about the situation where, you know, it's just unsafe because of the amount of clutter? It's not physically unsound, but there's a real concern about that person going in. So from the landlord's point of view, you know, we can't change locks,
right? There's a state law that prohibits us from recovering possession without a court order. And we face this all the time where, you know, it's Friday at 4 o'clock and most judges in the Commonwealth are on their way home. What are we doing? How are we preventing this person from coming in? There are some cases where we can't. We're going to go into court on Monday. We're going to get in really quickly, but and we'll talk about the ways that we do that. Anybody want to add any experience they've had of? Yep. Well, I think you have an obligation to enforce the state sanitary code, right? So there are landlords who are going to be, you know what, it's quiet, my rent gets paid every month, you know, I don't have to find a new tenant, I don't want to see, I don't want to hear. Those aren't good, you know, good landlords. But I think you have an obligation under the state sanitary code to cite the person and to enforce the provisions. And, you know, obviously under the state sanitary code, you have significant powers. You know, you have the power to cite and fine. You have the ability to then bring a criminal complaint for noncompliance, you know, in the district court. You do have discretion there. Not every case requires you to do that, and you're viewed with that discretion. But, yeah, you do have a duty to enforce the state sanitary code. Which brings me to my next point is, do you have the power and authority to cite the resident, the tenant, for the violation?
Yes.
Right? So, you know, there are several provisions of the code specifically that apply. 410.602b, tenant's obligation to maintain the unit in a clean and sanitary condition, free of garbage, that one. 4.451, not to obstruct passageways, that applies to everyone. 410.352, the tenant has a duty to maintain toilets, sinks, and showers in a clean condition. So, you know, absolutely, you have the ability to cite the tenant, and in fact, what the landlord often wants to see is the town cite the tenant, because then we have the ability to say it's not just us; it's the town has deemed this unsafe. And again, the Board of Health can even seek injunctions, right? You can seek a court order requiring the person to make the corrections, or face contempt of court, and we see that all the time. Not any of my clients, but. So the other benefit of the Board of Health going in for the landlord, and also for a judge, is it is sort of the impartial person looking, right? So someone was talking to me before about, you know, the landlord has their own view of things, the tenant has their own view. We often look to the Board of Health or the building department as sort of this impartial entity that's coming in and saying, yes, we see a problem, or no, we don't see a problem, and to be able to work cooperatively with them. So I think it's often overlooked that it's really important from our point of view when the Board of Health goes in that we do get a citation, hopefully to the tenant, not to the landlord, so that we can use that to take the next step. So I now want to talk about some practical approaches before we have to actually go to court. These are sort of approaches that we've developed over the years when we're dealing with these situations. So one thing that I find very helpful, we talked before about, you know, say, hey, clean your apartment, declutter it, right? It's just, you might as well be speaking, you know, Swahili to them. One is to develop a written plan that really goes step by step through how you're going to address these concerns, right? For example, week one, you're going to remove everything from your countertop, right? That's week one, or maybe that's week one and two, right? And it's not going to go anyplace else in the apartment. It's either going to go into a cabinet or it's going to go out. And then week two, nothing on the bathroom floor, right? Week three, nothing on the beds. You know, week four, we're going to go step by step with very specific instructions of what has to happen. Very objective criteria that we're going to set up. And again, a lot of times it's actually working on the most dangerous issues first. So for example, if it's a stove issue, if there's stuff on the stove, maybe it's day one. Right now, you're going to remove everything within 3 feet of your stove. And you know what we're also making clear in this agreement is that you know, this isn't a merry-go-round, right? It's not stuff just going around in a circle around the apartment. Off the stove, goes into the bathroom, bathroom goes back on the stove, right? It's physically the things are going to be going out. But I think by developing, and what we found is by developing very specific, detailed plan that is achievable, the person can actually start addressing the issues. And especially because many people with this disability, with OCD and with hoarding, are people who are very detail-oriented, right? They're often caught up in the minutiae of things. And I was corrected earlier. I am told now that hoarding is a separate diagnosis. So again, I'm not a mental health provider. So that's good to know. But because of the way this often works, they are often very much into the minutia, right? Which is often what makes it hard to do an agreement, because often they're caught more in the way the language is stated more than the actual what we're doing here, right? I don't like the word whereas. What does whereas mean? Why do we have to have whereas in the agreement? You know, that becomes a big fight. But step by step, and confirming what the result of not doing that is. You know, if this is not done, we are going to court. We are doing whatever. Also, the fact that you know, if there's going to be services in place, that the person is going to accept the services. And what I usually put in the agreement is also that the person consents to the service provider confirming whether the services are being accepted. I don't need to know necessarily anything else beyond that. I don't need to know anything diagnostic. I don't need to know anything else. I need to know you have, yes, they've complied with their service plan. No, they have not. Okay? So again, clear steps, no general concepts. The second thing that we found very effective is to use a specific criteria for removing property of trash bags. You are going to remove 3 full trash bags a week until further notice. And again, it gives them the control to decide what is going to be in those trash bags. We provide the trash bags. We get large black trash bags and have them put them out on a certain day so we can have verification, right? So I want to know what's in the trash bags, and I want to see them coming out. So every Monday morning, you're going to put 3 trash bags in front of your door. My staff member is going to come down, is going to see the stuff, take it out to the dumpster, and we actually look through it. We're going to empty it out and see. We had one case where the person was putting out 3 trash bags a week. They were filled with toilet paper. So she was just taking toilet paper, putting in the bag, 3 full bags. They were pretty light bags, so we knew something was up. You know, we need to verify it. But again, it's easy to explain to somebody. 3 bags. It does start to address the clutter issue. It gives them still the control to decide what those things are. And it's, again, a very effective way of dealing with this. And again, even when we deal with that, we set up that sort of system, I'm still dealing with the emergency issues first. I'm dealing with fire safety, stoves, heaters, furnaces, right? And verifying it. And then, of course, it's keeping it that way, right? So we often have, you know, the biggest issue is people bringing stuff back in. So one thing is we always want an agreement that they're going to allow us to take photographs, okay, because I want to document the condition. My position is that a property owner has the right to photograph their property. So a lot of people say, well, you can't take pictures. I don't agree with that. I think it's the owner owns the property. We can take pictures. Obviously, we don't take pictures of the people. We just take pictures of the property. But I want to document what the condition is. And we put in the agreements that you cannot bring anything else into the property other than food, medication, okay? Nothing else comes in. So those are two sort of practical approaches that we've used that seem to be effective at dealing with the issue before we get to court. Anybody have any other ways that they've sort of set up with people to deal with this?
No, but just a question though, about what percentage, when you try this approach, is effective?
That's a good question. And it really is dependent, in my experience, of whether or not there are services in place to assist the person. You know, when we do this to a person on their own, they're just out there, tends not to be very successful. If there's somebody there who can sit down with the person and say, okay, we need to fill these three bags, what can we do? Which, do you want this to go or stay? That's going to be effective. You know, from a property management point of view, property management staff normally is not going to do that. They're normally not going to touch anybody's stuff, right? You likely also are not going to touch anyone's stuff, right, for fear of them claiming that you broke it or stole it or whatever. So I guess my experience would be, as a component with social services, it can be very effective. Without the social services component, it tends not to be very effective. Yeah.
Do you have any follow-up afterwards once the person gets to the point where they're in compliance because the recidivism rate is?
Right. No, we absolutely have a provision of our agreement that says we're going to reinspect. So there are sometimes when we put in the agreement that we're allowed to reinspect without notice, just a knock on the door. And that's going to be more when it's a life safety issue, right? If I think the person is still bringing in stuff and putting it on the stove, I'm probably going to put that in my agreement. If it's not that sort of situation, it's just clutter, I'm going to allow for inspections either, you know, often we'll do weekly inspections, and then we'll do biweekly inspections, and then we'll do monthly inspections, and we'll sort of, because also we want to try to respect the person's you know, right to privacy. Also, you know, at large property, the manager doesn't want to be doing inspections every day. They've got other things to do. But we're gonna taper it down. But absolutely, we're gonna keep going back.
How about the owner-occupied place? Are you allowed to arrange for inspections? Is that totally voluntary on the owner?
Right. So let's talk about. Well, I'm dealing with apartment complexes. Let's talk a little bit about, you know,
that's
your
problem.
Right.
Hey,
right. You got a single-family home, right? So you do have the ability to come to an agreement with somebody to try to resolve the violations. And whether that's in court or informally, you can come up with an agreement. And again, in that agreement, they can consent to these inspections, what they're going to do to address it. I think these techniques are the same, whether it's a 400-unit apartment or it's a single-family home. You know, moving a couple bags out a day may be a good way of helping the person deal with it. Saying, I'm coming back on Tuesday. I'm going to reinspect on Tuesday. When I come back on Tuesday, there can't be anything on that stove. Can't be anything within 3 feet of the stove. And then I'm going to come back a week later, and I'm going to inspect that bathroom. There can't be anything on the floor of the bathroom. Again, I think it's a very practical approach to dealing with the issue. And the remedy you have, sort of the for lack of a better word, the anvil you have over the person's head is, my next step is probably going to court and filing a criminal complaint.
No, the stick.
It's a, yeah, stick or carrot, it just depends on. Yeah.
Local remedies for us have included free dumpsters provided by DPW with a time limit as to when they can, when they must be filled up by, and the sheriff's office providing prisoners to help move stuff. I don't know if there's other communities are using that too.
Well, that's a great, okay. What town are you in?
In Yarmouth, it's possible.
Yarmouth. Okay. I mean, that's two great resources. I can imagine residents being very hesitant to allow prisoners to come in and.
The prisoners are primarily dealing with stuff that's outside the
right.
House on the grounds, and that's where, as a building official, I'm much more commonly involved.
Right, you're probably more commonly involved because the neighbor's calling and saying next door they have 1,400 used tires in the yard.
Right.
Right.
I've also worked
Okay. Yep.
The thing is that as a building official, I'm all about enforcement.
Yep.
Not services, and I don't know where the services might come from.
And that's a great point because, for example, in Brookline, right, it's the Board of Health and Human Services, right? So they, and I've often said to them, and they have a very, very, I think, very good director, and he's very involved, but they often are looking more at social services than necessarily enforcement. And it's a good question. You know, I'm just the building inspector, right? I don't provide social services. That's another, you know, go down the hall for that.
Right. Well, I can't. I have jurisdiction, you know, and I can't go beyond it.
No, what I'm saying is, right, you have to say, I'm citing you, you have to fix this. If you need help, go down the hall. That's not my, right?
But where, what hall?
Yeah, there's no hall.
Yeah.
I think that's where the Cape Cod Hoarding Task Force is sort of filling in the gap. We have people who come to our meetings and we discuss, we do case consultations, and sort of talk about what insurance they have or, you know, given their age, what might be available that they don't really think about. So, and we're really promoting this joint service plan where people are working together. So there's, it's not the hot potato being passed around from agency to agency. And I think we've gotten better results that way. So I'd say if someone's really stuck, they should come to one of our meetings and we can help them figure it out.
Hmm. Yep.
Talk about the practical approach with all of this going before court. What intervention are you recommending for the prevention of the continuation of acquiring items so that this doesn't affect the process in terms of dealing with the underlying issues as to why they're acquiring with the disorder?
Right. Well, the hard part is that, you know, from a property owner's point of view, I can't necessarily deal with the underlying issue.
Right.
Right? I can't force you to get services. I can just say, you know, you got to maintain your apartment in a certain condition. So for us, it's reinspecting and documenting and following up on it.
When you're saying that in the agreement they are agreeing to accept services, are you getting as specific as to what those services are, and does any of that include therapy?
So I will tell you that a lot of times we won't get necessarily involved in the minutia of what their plan is. But especially in jurisdictions that have a tenancy preservation program or where some social services provider is coming to court or to a meeting with them, I'm going to look at what their service plan is. I may attach that as a part of the agreement that they're going to comply with the service plan, but I'm not going to micromanage the service plan. But I might, as part of an agreement, say you're going to comply with the recommendations of your provider. You know, for some providers, and there are some providers in the room here, it gets a little hairy for them, right? Because it puts them in the position where if the person is no longer complying, they know that if they call me, I'm going to boot the person out. So they don't want to call me and say, hey, they're not complying anymore. On the other hand, I've sort of given them a duty in the agreement. For me, more, it's to enforce to the resident, hey, you know, you got to start complying with your service plan. And if you don't, there's going to be a remedy here. And the remedy may be that you're out of this apartment.
Who develops the service plan?
The social services provider. From a landlord's point of view, I would never, ever develop, you know, a service plan. We have no knowledge of that, and I'm also going to get into potentially, you know, a lot of this comes back to the reasonable accommodation, right? This is the accommodation I'm going to give you. It is comply with this agreement, including your service plan. You know, I'm not necessarily entitled to know even, like, the details of your care. I don't want to know. I just want to know that there's a provider that you're following their plan. And if that plan changes, great, but you're complying. And that's also the hardest part to enforce in my agreements. Yep?
Now, mostly we've been talking about stuff inside the property. What about outside? Stuff in the yard. Just all over the place.
Right. So it's no different. I mean, to me, so first of all, you got to, is there as much of a safety issue, right? Sometimes there is, sometimes there's not. And the more the safety issue, the more aggressive we're going to take an approach. But if you've got stuff outside, you know, for example, it's a harbinger for rodents, right? That's the biggest issue I see when the stuff is outside. There's animals getting in there, there's rodents getting in there, and it becomes a real public health concern. Creates a lot of standing water, which leads to those horrible mosquitoes that we're all going to die from. So that becomes a big issue. But it's no different. It just may be that it's not as emergent an issue if it's just some stuff outside. It still needs to be dealt with. Still a violation of the code. Well, state sanitary code, and also maybe a violation of the zoning code. Oftentimes, if it's like motor vehicles or other structures, things like that, it's a violation of the zoning code too. Okay, so let's talk quickly about what if that doesn't work, right? What if the you know, the soft approach is not effective? In those cases, we often need to get court intervention. And again, sometimes it's just the soft approach hasn't worked. Sometimes it's, I'm not going with a soft approach. I got a real issue. I got that place, right? The building's going to fall down. I've got you know, unsafe conditions. And from my client's point of view, we're concerned about liability, right? And we're going to go into court. And we're going to go into court, and it's what I would call a win-win situation, right? If I go to court and the judge says, no, don't do anything, and there's a fire tomorrow, I say, well, go down and talk to the judge, right? Maybe the judge will act differently next time. If the judge allows it, great. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go down and I'm going to file a civil case, either in the housing court if I have one, or the district court, or the superior court in some cases, seeking a restraining order compelling the person to do something. And what I ask the judge to do depends on the circumstances. There are plenty of cases where I've asked the judge to prohibit the person from being on the property and from occupying the unit because it's unsafe and uninhabitable, right? Especially if I have something from the Board of Health saying that. And I'm going to go in and I'm going to ask the judge to make sure this person can't go back. Because again, I can't prohibit that person from coming on the property without a court order. I can't lock the doors. Even if I've got it's about to collapse or about to die, I technically can't change the locks. I need a court order. So I may run in that day and get a court order locking the doors. I may ask the judge for a different order. I may ask the judge to issue an order compelling the person to restore their unit to a safe and habitable condition. It all depends on the circumstances. Now, I also can bring. I also have the right under the state sanitary code to bring an action, right? There's a private right of enforcement under the state sanitary code that I read as giving me the right under that, too, if there's a violation. But again, how does this work? I file a complaint. I seek either a temporary restraining order that day, asking for some remedy, or I may get a hearing a few days later. It's very rare that a judge is going to do something like this without even giving the other side notice of it. But I may have a hearing a day or two later. I'm going to ask for this court to issue a preliminary injunction. One of a couple things happens when I do that. One is we get to court, and the tenant doesn't show up, right? And that happens a lot. The resident doesn't show up. In that case, I'm normally going to get my court order. Usually I win when the other side doesn't show up. But again, you have to consider what you're asking for, right? Even in that case, a judge may be very hesitant to order somebody just off the property with a couple days' notice. It all depends on the circumstances. I've had plenty of cases where I've done that. I've said to a judge, this is just so unsafe, such a risk for a fire, that pending a further order, you need to give me authority to lock the doors. I did that on Friday in a hoarding case, and the judge allowed it. The judge locked the doors. We had to get the person out, it's a little bit harsh, but again, the safety issues override that. I may ask the judge again for them to restore the unit within 7 days or something, okay? And I hear all the time, well, how can you do this by injunction? Don't you need to bring an eviction case? And I don't think so. I mean, if there was a bomb in the apartment, I don't think anyone would say, well, file an eviction case. We'll see you in 7 weeks, 5 weeks, right? And let's see what happens with the bomb. No, everyone would expect me to go in and get an emergency order. It's the same to me here. This is a bomb waiting to go off, right? This is a potential life-threatening issue. So that's what happens when the tenant doesn't show up. A lot of times the tenant does show up. What happens there? Well, our goal at that point is to get an agreement in place. And again, it's going to be the same as that informal agreement we talked about. I'm going to sit down with them, and I'm going to say, here's how we're going to address this. We're going to either go step by step by step by step. Here's what we're going to do today. I'm going to write this up as a court-ordered agreement that has teeth in it. And the teeth normally is, if you violate a court order, what happens? You're in contempt of court, right? Judges don't like when you don't follow court orders. They can put you in jail. You know, I once had a guy put in jail for violating one of these orders. Judge can fine somebody. Judge can enter other relief. Might issue an order then prohibiting the person from the property. But again, it's going to set this up and give them a chance to comply. Again, I always want a provision allowing me to do inspections. And I always want the ability to do photos. Because it gets difficult when I say hoarding. You know, someone before said, well, how do I know, you know, I look at hoarding one way, somebody else looks at hoarding another way. How will a judge look at it? The problem is, you know, judges rarely go out to the apartment. So we want pictures. I want to be able to show the judge, you know, those pictures that are in the packet I gave out to you, so they go, wow, okay, yeah, this is hoarding. So I want plenty of pictures. And again, I want my agreement to be very clear on what this person is going to do step by step. Sometimes when the tenant shows up, I need to go before the judge, right? I need to go before the judge and say, this is what's happening. Judge, what do you want me to do, right? It puts a lot of burden on the judge, but that's what judges, that's why they get the big paychecks and get those fancy robes. Sometimes there's a real benefit to going before the judge. And even sometimes when they have an agreement, I'm going to put the person before the judge. Because the judge, to someone who has this condition, often is a figure of authority, right? They sit up higher than us, yeah. Right? They got the nice robe on. And a good judge will actually understand what they're doing. They'll understand that they are, for lack of a better word, reading them the riot act. They're making it clear this has gone far enough. You do have a problem now. You need to take care of it. So I will have a judge read through the agreement and explain it to the person, make sure they understand it, and are going to put that person in the position where they now understand they need to deal with this. And sometimes that is a very effective way. Sometimes it's a lawyer, right? Sometimes the scary lawyer is the enough of a diversion for them that, oh my God, I see I got a problem now. I got a legal case against me. But sometimes that judge really can reinforce it for somebody there. Sometimes we need to get what's called a guardian ad litem appointed. So a guardian ad litem is going to be involved. A judge will appoint the person. They're usually a lawyer. And they're going to make sure the person's interests are being protected in the court case. But often they'll go beyond that. Often they can be a resource to go out and see what that person's doing, help them get the services, advocate for them. Sometimes, you know, landlords look at it as a bad thing because it slows things down a little bit. But I usually look at it as a good thing because now I have somebody who's got this person's interests in mind. You know, I'm the lawyer for the landlord. I technically don't have this person's interests in mind. The guardian ad litem will and may recommend things and can also sign an agreement for the person. So it can be a very effective tool to ask for. You also have another very effective way to deal with homeowners, right? Somebody that's not preparing their unit. Anybody? Receivership, right? How many of you have done that? Gotten a receivership, okay? So you have the ability to go in and have the court appoint a receiver to basically take over a property, right? And to do all the things that this owner needs to do. Hire people to come out and clean, remove things, make repairs, right? Fix the roof. And all of those costs get assessed to that homeowner. It's a very effective tool if you have somebody that maybe has a little bit of a mental health component, but also maybe is a little bit, for lack of a better word, ornery, right? You're not going to make me do this in my house. I have the right to do whatever I want in my house. This is my home. You can't force me to do anything. You start threatening receivership, which is it's expensive, right? Those receivers aren't cheap, and they're going to come in. They're going to do everything. A very effective tool to use either as a carrot to get the person to move in the right direction or a stick if they won't because there's a big financial burden there. I see it in housing court all the time. The Board of Health or the Building Department going in, town council going in, getting a receiver appointed, and it can be very, very effective.
The other thing I will say about the court case is sometimes it can be very cathartic. And what I mean by that is sometimes it will cause enough friction that it will loosen things up. Family members will suddenly come forward that you never heard of before, right? Friends will come forward. People in the community will go forward now because there is this event. Caseworkers will show up that you never knew existed because suddenly they are, the person's calling up their caseworker and saying, I got served with this complaint. I got to go to court next Tuesday. I don't know what to do. It'll get that involved. Sometimes it will also get legal services involved, which sometimes can be a good thing because, again, they may be able to access services or get things for the resident that they need and prevent them from being evicted. So to me, sometimes filing these court cases is the most humane way of dealing with these things. It actually gets the person the help that they need. I was telling somebody the story about we had a resident who was a Vietnam vet and was not only hoarding but had a number of other issues. And we brought him to court. We really didn't know the resident. It was a site that didn't have an on-site manager. Guy had been there for a while. And they brought him into court because of this issue. But they really had never met him. And when he came in, I approached him. I said, hi, I'm Attorney Turk. I represent your landlord. And he said, oh, I'm glad you're here. He said, people keep breaking into my apartment. You see someone broke in and they cut my finger off. And he had a finger, of course. So I said, okay, I think we have a little mental health component here. He then said, somebody broke in and circumcised me in my sleep. Okay, we have a major mental health issue here. The horrible thing in that case was the VA took the position that until the person was actually evicted, they would not provide services. So we actually had to have this paranoid schizophrenic physically removed from his property. It was heart-wrenching. And here we had a landlord that was trying to be humane and trying to help the guy, and the social services never came in. And it was actually a horrible situation. But a lot of times it does get the services out there for the person. Sometimes we do actually have to remove the person from the property. There are sometimes that a tenant simply is not otherwise qualified to be there. There are times that we've gotten court orders to be allowed to physically go in and remove all the belongings. So the case I was talking to you about at the beginning with the person who had the 5 feet of paper you couldn't even get in, you had to like crawl over and slide in. We tried everything. We tried the bag by bag. Didn't work. We tried that. We'll just do this little area. Did not work. It was an elderly woman, in the city of Boston. Ultimately, Judge Winnick in the housing court issued us an order authorizing us to go in and physically remove everything from that apartment. We took the windows out. We put those slides in, dumpsters, and the landlord paid to have everything taken out, everything. And it was extremely traumatic for this woman, right? Because, again, she had lost all control. But it was a last-ditch effort to try to keep her in the housing. And we arranged for her to be out. We actually had someone go and take her out for the day. While she was gone, everything was removed other than a couch, chair, and tables, and all that. And it was a last-ditch effort to do it. It's one of the rare times I've ever seen a judge do that. Didn't work out, right? So you asked, what are the odds of winning here, right? This stuff just started coming in again. And ultimately, she was moved to what I would call more appropriate housing. But sometimes it goes to that point. But there are times when maybe assisted living is better. Yep.
Could you do that with a single-family home?
I think you could ask a judge to do that. I think it's within the judge's powers to grant you that remedy.
And even when the occupant is the owner?
If there is a threat to public safety and it's unsafe and unsanitary, I think the judge has the discretion to do that. Different judges are going to do it differently, right? And again, I'm an advocate of the housing courts, right? I practice in the housing courts and the district courts.
We don't have that.
And that's why I don't understand why. There are I think two counties in the state that don't have them. When you're dealing in housing court, you're dealing with judges that this is all they do, right? This is their expertise, right? It's like me going into probate court. I have no idea what I'm doing there, right? Put me in housing court, I know it all, right? Or supposedly. Housing court judges, no, they've dealt with it. They're going to give you those orders. District court judges, I think just because it's not their field, most of them have never dealt with housing law. They didn't do it when they were in private practice, before they were judges. They don't know, right? So a lot of it depends on the judge. I think a lot depends on the seriousness of it, right? You know, that house, the any judge is going to say, yeah, right?
It was on the weekend anyway, so we didn't have access to the courts.
Right.
And we just did it.
Well, and you know, I'm going to say this on camera. I've had clients who have locked doors. I have clients who have apartments been so unsafe and unsanitary and such a threat to the other residents that they've considered it an emergency, and they've done it. And they've risked it. They've said, you know what? I'm going to risk being liable for 3 months' rent under this statute. But I'm not going to have this person moving back in. I'm going to say it's unsafe and unsanitary, and it's Saturday morning, and we're going to lock the door. And
they wound up having to tear this house down. It wasn't even salvageable. It was
okay, so... So that's really the, yeah, go ahead.
Could you address the potential liability for a town if they are aware of something, of a sanitary code and fire code violations? The client, the resident has said they will fix it, and then the town doesn't go back to check, and there's a fire and possibly a death. Is there a...
Well, the town has some immunity from those types of lawsuits, and you know, my bigger concern always is, you know, you probably don't have liability, but you're probably going to get sued, right? And so, you know, preventative lawyering would say, just because you probably would win, doesn't mean you're not going to get the lawsuit filed against you and spend the next 2 years in court, you know, with your town council being very upset with you for having not gone back. So I think. You want to be going back and checking up on these things and dealing with it. And you know, I think often the ignoring it doesn't really help anybody. You know, the turning the blind eye, you know, I have clients that say, you know, well, it's not hoarding yet, and so I'm just going to not look the other way because I don't want to do it. And we say, well, is that really the best approach? It's not helping the tenant. It's just going to get worse. And you're going to have a bigger problem when it comes up. And of course, when you evict a tenant and it's, this is the apartment they leave behind, you know, who pays to get rid of all the stuff? The landlord. So it's really a no-win situation. So that's really my presentation. But I'm very interested to hear, anybody else want to share any information or questions or concerns?
Appearances that you're talking about, or would they turf it to say Orleans or Barnstable and have someone who's really not adequate dealing with it because they don't have family court issues normally?
Right, so it's not family court. You would never go to family court. You would either go to the superior court, so you don't have a housing court. So certain towns have housing courts, certain counties, you don't. So you would have the district court or the superior court. You know, the difference between superior court and district court, not to overly bore you, is district court has jurisdiction below $25,000, superior court over $25,000. There's actually a case that says if there's no money involved, which these cases have no money involved, you have to go to superior court because zero. We bring most of these cases in district court or superior court depending on factors, and you'd really want to talk to your town council about where they think it's going to be most effectively heard. There's really great district court judges. There's really great Superior Court judges. It's really a litigation question.
So it doesn't physically have to go up to Plymouth, is what I was getting at.
If you have a housing court in your jurisdiction, if you're in Plymouth, there is a housing court.
Right.
And I would always use the housing. I personally, again, this is really up to your individual lawyers. I would always use a housing court. I know there's always concerns. Some people have good luck in housing, some people don't. They have TPP. They're more experienced in this. I tend to think that they're better suited for this. But
I'm thinking the client's going to say, I can't get transportation up to Plymouth, so I'm not going to show, or I'm not going to be able to show. So
Yeah, well, that's a problem for, I mean, the Cambridge District Court is in Medford. I don't know, it moved to Medford. The Middlesex Superior Court used to be in downtown Cambridge, now it's in Woburn. Nobody can get there. Tenants can't get there. We don't decide where the courts get put.
But if we're on the Cape and we have a housing issue, we don't go to Plymouth Housing Court, we deal with the on Cape District Superior
Court.
Right,
right. Yeah. Other questions, other concepts, other ideas?
Now, it's only a judge that can remove an owner from their own property. And is there any obligation to house that person financially?
The Board of Health can condemn an owner occupied.
You can condemn it, but the question is then if they don't comply, you got to go to court to... I mean, when you condemn a property, do you change the locks to it? Or do you issue an order of condemnation? And then if they don't comply, you go to court and get a court order to physically bar the person from the property. Okay, well, these are tough issues, right? And I hope, you know, as I usually tell my associates when they go to legal things, if you learn one behind the back dribble, you're probably good. So I hope this is helpful. I hope that you'll continue to be involved with the coalition because it seems like they're doing good work. And have a good lunch.
Thank you.